Oh yeah, I do. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I do.
So I've been assigned to the task, the very pleasurable task of introducing our next speaker is Dr. Walter Block. Walter, who is today's Mr. Libertarian, is the author of more books and scholarly articles and popular articles than I could possibly count. He has an eminent scholar at Loyola University in New Orleans. He's the Pied Piper of libertarianism among students. Whenever he's at any university, immediately he's gathering great crowds of students around him and teaching them. He's great, and he does a lot in Louisiana too, of course. So Walter's a senior fellow of the Mises Institute. Just an example to all of us as to how one should live one's life if you want to promote liberty. So it's my great honor to introduce to you now Dr. Walter Block.
Thanks, Lou, for the great introduction. Once when I lectured at a Mises Institute event, Ron Paul spoke right before me. It was rough coming on right after Ron Paul. Imagine how I felt. But now I come right after Tom Woods and Lew Rockwell, people that I think are, apart from Ron Paul, the second and third people who have contributed the most to liberty in the modern day. So I must be something special to have these people as my warm-up act. Ron Paul hasn't lost yet. He could still be our president. We have a saying in Louisiana that if you get caught in bed with a dead boy or a live girl, and I'm not sure which way it is, you lose your credentials. Well, who knows what'll happen tomorrow or tonight. But it's most likely that it'll be Obama versus Romney. I happen to favor Obama of those two because I think he's less likely to drop a nuclear bomb on anyone. I also happen to favor Obama over McCain for the very same reason in the last election. But happily, we don't have that as our only choice. We also have Gary Johnson. And if Gary Johnson gets more than the difference between these two, Obama and Romney, liberty will live even more. My Ron Paul book is out. It's my love letter to him. I will be signing a few copies, but if you're interested in getting this book, it's on Amazon, available on Amazon. We have various sayings that we say. We say, end the Fed. We say, President Paul. We say, legalize drugs. I've got a new one. Now, I've been working on this. The long version of it, which is too long for a quick saying, is Ron Paul in 2016 for president. The short version is Paul 16. Paul 16. He'll only be 80 years old then. He'll be a young 80, and he'll be able to beat anyone else in a bicycle race, even if they're 40 or 50. You know, libertarianism is okay in theory, but if you really want to get something done, you have to use coercion and threats. I'm just kidding. So what we've got to do is draft Ron Paul, force him, compel him to run in 16, Paul 16. But enough rabble-rousing. You people are the rabble, I'm the rouser. Ron Paul called me not once but twice last week, and he said, don't give a rabble-rousing speech. Instead, do something substantive. I mean, when Ron Paul calls you, it's sort of like Ludwig von Mises calling you, or, I don't know, Aristotle calling you or something. I mean, or God calling you. I mean, I was just amazed that he would call me and ask me to do something substantive. So in what follows, what I'm going to try to do is to apply libertarian theory to a very complicated, controversial issue. And there's going to be a quiz on this at the end, so you better take notes. No applause, no standing and applauding, but take notes because there's going to be a quiz. See, I'm a professor. If I don't do this, they'll kick me out. So I've got to do something very serious and very substantive. The issue has been arisen because of Aiken, the guy who's running for senator of Missouri, and he talks about legitimate rape, and this brings up the question of abortion. So I'm going to address the question of what is the proper libertarian view on abortion? Stop booing me. This is a very controversial issue. And I have a new theory called evictionism, and if I don't get through, if I get the yank before I'm finished, email me or go to my web, walterblock.com, email me and I'll send you about 15 articles I've written on this. I think it's a very important issue because lives are at stake, young human beings are dying. Now, I'm neither pro-life nor pro-choice, although my heart is with pro-life, as is Ron Paul. But we're losing. We're losing. I mean, right now, they have partial birth abortions where they go into the fetus in the ninth month and take his brains out and then deliver him dead. This is just outright murder. So I'm going to offer a compromise, and my compromise is what I call a principled compromise. An unprincipled compromise would be, you say 2 plus 2 is 4, I say 2 plus 2 is 6, so we compromise 2 plus 2 is 5. That's not a principled compromise. I've got what I think is a principled compromise that is true to libertarianism in a way that even pro-life is not true to libertarianism. So I'm going to offer you this theory on two grounds. One, utilitarian. On the ground that it'll save lives now, and we will win the pro-life side if we adopt evictionism and reject pro-life. And secondly, because it's deontologically correct. I think it's the only theory compatible with libertarianism. Well, what is libertarianism? The non-aggression axiom, no force, no fraud, no threats, and private property rights. We need private property rights because if I grab your shirt, did I commit theft? No, it depends if you're the rightful owner of it. If you stole it from me yesterday, and then I'm just repossessing my own property. So it's very important that we steer clear of evading either of these two, because these are the opposite sides of the coin of libertarianism, private property rights and non-aggression. Another assumption I'm going to make is that the fertilized egg is a young human being. Because the sperm alone will not become a human being, the egg alone will not become a human being, but the fertilized egg, if put in the right environment, will become a human being. It's a very young human being, but it's a human being. So I'm starting with that principle. I believe it's true, and also I will not be taking the pro-life point of view. I will defend the killing of some of these young human beings. And I don't want to make a straw man argument for myself. I want to make a hard argument for myself to show that the evictionist theory can deal with even difficult challenges. So what is evictionism? Evictionism is the idea that the mother has a right to evict, to rid herself of the fetus whenever she wants, but not to kill it. It's a complex concept. It's very similar to labor unions. What is the libertarian view on labor unions? Are we in favor or against the strike? Well, the strike, too, is a complex phenomenon. On the one hand, it's a mass quit. And everybody has a right to quit. If an individual has a right to quit a job, if he doesn't, he's a slave. He doesn't lose it if other people quit also. Although in the early days of labor unionism, they put people in jail for quitting en masse. You have a right to quit en masse. But the second part of the strike is a blockade or a trespass. You keep scabs out and you don't allow the owner to conduct his business. So are we for or against strikes? We compromise on that. We say, well, a strike is a good thing and a bad thing. Well, I say it's the same thing with evictionism. It's a good thing and a bad thing. Or rather, abortion is a good thing and a bad thing. The good thing is eviction, because of private property rights, the woman owns her womb. On the other hand, it's a bad thing. You're killing a human being. So it's a principled compromise. The pro-life people believe you don't have a right to evict or to kill. You have to carry the fetus for 9 months. The pro-choice people believe you have a right to evict at any time, even in the ninth month, if it'll kill, and you have a right to kill. Whereas the evictionist takes one from each side, so it's a true compromise. Namely, we believe you have a right to evict, but not to kill. Now, sometimes in the early days of a baby, the only way to evict is to kill. And my theory favors this on libertarian grounds. Let me explain. What I'm saying is that the unwanted fetus is a trespasser. There's this philosopher, Judith Jarvis Thompson, and she comes up with this case. You go to bed, and you wake up the next morning, and you're connected with an umbilical tube to somebody else. And you turn to this person, and you say, how come you happen to be in my bed connected to my kidney? And he says, I don't know. I went to sleep last night in a hospital. It must have been some renegade doctor who attached us. Do you have a right to shoot him? No. Do you have to stick with him for the rest of his life? No. You can evict him. You can take him to the hospital and say, look, doctors, you know, cut this umbilical cord, I want to evict him. I think that this is a good analogy for the mother who wants to evict the baby. Notice, when I say the unwanted fetus is a trespasser, it's easy to see in the case of rape. A young woman walks down the street, she gets grabbed, she gets impregnated, and now there's something growing in her that she didn't agree to, and it's a trespasser. If that's not a trespasser, then nothing is a trespasser. If she doesn't have a right to evict that human being, because it's innocent, it didn't commit rape, children are not guilty for their parents' crimes. If she doesn't have a right to evict that fetus, then we might as well kiss private property rights goodbye. But all fetuses are equal in their rights to life, the product of rape and the product of voluntary sexual intercourse. So what I'm saying is that not only does the woman have a right to evict the product of rape, but also to evict any fetus at any time for any reason because it's her private property. She has a right to evict if she changes her mind, because the womb is her private property. Now let me deal with a few objections. The first one is, well, she agreed. When she had the sexual intercourse, she agreed to possibly have a baby. Well, and she has to made her bed, she has to lie in it. Well, just because you make a bed, you don't have to lie in it. That's not a libertarian premise. The libertarian premise is private property rights, and she still has private property rights over her womb, even if she agreed to something. The second one is that she knew full well. Well, another point is that some people don't know. They're ignorant. Many, many years ago, people didn't know how babies came. They thought from the stork or whatever. The third one is that she had a contract. Now, if it was a host mother, then she has a contract and then she can't evict. Fine. But if there's no host mother situation, there's no contract. Now, let me explain the birds and the bees with you. You see, when intercourse occurs, there is no fertilized egg. It takes a little while for the sperm to get to the egg. So at the time of intercourse, she couldn't have had a contract with the fetus, even if we allow fetuses to have contracts, because you have to have two people to have a contract. And there was no two people at the time of intercourse. Later on, an hour or whenever, I'm not biologist enough to say, but later on. So I reject these objections. Another one is, suppose I invite you into my plane, my airplane, and now we're at 30,000 feet, and I say, okay, leave. Well, here there is an implicit contract. Namely, if I invite you to my plane or my boat, I'm obligated to get you back on Earth. So I reject these objections. Now, what are the benefits? The benefits are, in adopting evictionism, we will be true to libertarian theory in a way that neither pro-life nor pro-choice is true to libertarianism. And what we want to do with libertarianism is to be accurate about it. We want to understand it. We don't want to just mouth it as a piety. We have to dig deep. We have to apply it rigidly, logically. And I think that evictionism does that. Secondly, there are utilitarian benefits. If we adopt evictionism, in one fell swoop, we save the lives of all kids in the third trimester. Seventh, eighth, and ninth month, no more. No more killing. You can evict, but you can't kill, because the fetus is viable in the seventh, eighth, and ninth month, and there will be people who will adopt these babies. So in one fell swoop, we save one-third of babies, which is pretty darn good for libertarian theory. Secondly, much better, every 10 years, medical science will progress if we don't blow ourselves up first. Which means that in 10 or 15 years, we'll be able to save babies in the sixth month. And then in 50 years, maybe in the fifth, fourth, third month. Does anyone doubt that in 200 or 300 years, medical science will be able to evict a baby and put it in a host mother, a test tube, or whatever magical thing they have in 200 years? We will have won in 200 years if we adopt evictionism. Whereas if we stick with pro-life, we won't win. We're losing. We're losing the war. You have this partial birth abortion. The majority of the populace, the majority of the electorate, favors pro-choice, so-called pro-choice. So with pro-life, we're never going to win. So I'm, in my heart, I'm pro-life. I want babies to be saved. I don't like mass murder, and this is mass murder. Thank you for your attention.